knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the last tutorial, we saw how, as a differential equation becomes more complicated, the harder it is to find a solution. But since differential equations are so essential to applied math, surely we can do better than trying a load of substitutions and hoping for the best? Indeed we can, because we have something that those dusty old mathematicians of the 18th century didn't have. We have computers. In this tutorial, we'll learn a way to approximate the solution to any differential equation, no matter how complicated. Let's suppose we have any general first-order initial value problem, which can be written in the form dy dx equals f of xy with some initial y of 0, which we'll call y sub 0. Knowing nothing at all about the function f, is there anything we can do? Recall that dy dx really represents the slope of the tangent to the curve when we plot y against x at a given point. Since we are starting with a given initial condition, we know that our solution must pass through the point 0, y sub 0, and we can calculate that the gradient of the tangent line to the solution at this point must be f of 0, y sub 0, since this is equal to dy dx in our differential equation. If we make the assumption that our solution is a well-behaved continuous function, then this tangent line will be a decent approximation to the solution for small steps away from this point. We can therefore take a tiny step to the right, call it h, and using the gradient equals rise over run formula, the resulting change in y on the tangent line will be f of 0 y sub 0 times h. The new y-coordinate is then y sub 0 plus h times f of 0 y sub 0, and we can use this as our new starting point and repeat the process, drawing a new tangent line, extrapolating the change in y, and adding to our current approximation. In general, we can write down what is known as Euler's method, x sub n plus 1 equals x sub n plus our step size h, and y sub n plus 1 equals y sub n plus h times f of x sub n, y sub n. This allows us to compute a whole sequence of y values starting from our initial condition and progressively approximating further and further into our solution, as long as our step size h is small enough to not stray too far from whatever the true solution may be. What if we weren't given an initial condition? In that case, we wouldn't have a fixed starting point, but we can still make some progress. We can represent the set of all possible starting tangent lines using a tangent field, sometimes known as a direction field. In this example, we have the differential equation dy dx equals x squared minus x minus 2, so our function f of xy is x squared minus x minus 2. If we were given an initial condition for some point, xy, we could plug it into f of xy to draw our initial tangent line, but since we don't have one, we need to sub in points all across the xy plane. For each point, we can draw the tiny tangent lines with the appropriate gradient, which will populate the tangent field, shown as the collection of green line segments on this graph. We can consider this a vector field, and the solutions to our dE are the field lines of this tangent vector field, shown by the colored curves on the graph. Each possible curve represents the solution with a different initial condition, so this is a way to visualize the family of curves making up the general solution. A way to help speed up the sketching of tangent fields is to first find the curves where dy dx is a constant, which are the contour lines of f, or also called the isoclines of the tangent field. In our case, since our function f of xy does not depend on y at all, the isoclines are all vertical lines. For example, notice that along the line x equals 2, all of the tangent lines have the same gradient. We can therefore see that all of the solution curves will simply be vertical translations of each other, which correspond to choosing different initial conditions. One issue with Euler's method is that you need an extremely tiny step size h in order to get accurate results, which makes computations slow and susceptible to rounding errors. This motivated the development of better numerical methods, so let's take a look at some of those now. An algorithm known as Heun's method, which is also simply called the improved Euler method, uses a two-step predictor-corrector approach to compensate for the change in gradient as we step from one point to the next. In Heun's method, the first step is the same, but then instead of using the old gradient, we replace it with the average of the gradients at the old point and the new point, giving a much closer approximation. An even more sophisticated algorithm is the Runge-Kutta fourth-order method, or RK4, which uses a point positioned between the start and end point to sample another value of the gradient and calculate the best estimate for where the solution is going. RK4 uses the formulae shown here, and it's actually the standard workhorse of most modern computational solvers for differential equations. So those are some good methods to solve any first-order differential equation, but what about second-order and even higher? We can use a trick we learned in the last tutorial for reducing the order of difficult differential equations. If we have a second-order DE in the general form x double prime equals some function of the independent variable t, the dependent variable x and its first derivative x prime, then we can create a new variable, call it v, defined as v equals dx dt, and this will lead to the formation of a system of two differential equations in two dependent variables, x and v. It might seem like we've made the problem harder, but note that these are both first order, and so we can now apply the numerical methods studied here to each equation, stepping through both variables at each point in time, approximating the solution as we go. For example, to apply Euler's method to this system, we calculate the estimates for both v and x at each time step. For more complicated numerical methods like Heun's method, we need to be a little more careful, since the calculation steps have interdependencies, so we need to evaluate each of the predictor and corrector substeps fully for each variable. Our calculations must therefore alternate between finding estimates for x and v, starting with x hat and v hat, and then the final estimates for x and v. Nowadays, scientific computing capabilities are at the fingertips of anyone who owns a laptop. With a little knowledge of coding, especially in a high-level programming language such as Python or MATLAB, we can write programs to implement these numerical algorithms automatically, solving even the most difficult of differential equations in the blink of an eye. There is a lot more that could be said about numerical methods, but that will be all for this tutorial, so let's check comprehension.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.